Okay, so we're about to get started. A few more things I want to tell you guys. So as I said, it's the 7th annual RedTalks conference. Thanks for being part of it. I'm really grateful to you, the audience, for being here. And I'm grateful to some other parties I would like to sort of express that gratitude to right now. The first is I'm grateful to these brave souls who are getting up in front of you. Public speaking is one of the greatest fears that humankind has. So I really want you to appreciate them and their bravery of getting up here and sharing their passions with us and their expertise with us. I'm grateful also to the instructors who submit work to Claro to be published. Not that many instructors do, honestly. We only have about 12, 13 instructors who regularly submit to us, so I would love to create a sort of groundswell movement among the students here that you begin pestering your instructors, like, hey, I got an A on that thing. Have you submitted it yet? You know? So the most change happens from the ground up, right? And so that's a great way to get published too, is to sort of pester your instructors. But I would love to get more instructors here submitting more work, but I'm so grateful to the ones who do. I'm also grateful to the instructors who bring their classes. Looks like probably someone has brought their class. Who's that? Is this you again? You back to back? You're just taking the day off. This isn't about supporting Claro. This is, I don't have to teach today. No, I'm kidding. No, but really, wink, wink, that's a great idea. I think I'll do that too. Oh my gosh. But no, I'm grateful to you for bringing your classes. No, don't leave, don't leave. Just kidding. And then the other thing I wanted to express some gratitude for is just the whole idea of what we're in this room together doing right now. What we're doing right now is really important. We're sharing our intellectual work. And our intellectual work is often also personal, which especially this panel embodies that. I think the best intellectual work we do is grounded in what's going on personally for ourselves and our lives. And so actually in the next panel has a lot of that going on too, that intersection of the personal and the academic. And so I think it's really important that we don't do work in our classes that just goes to the professor and gets a grade. And then we're done, cash clear, right? That feels so inauthentic to me. Some of us are doing such amazing, groundbreaking work in our classes, and the fact that we've all shown up here today to benefit from that, to share that, to continue the conversation beyond this room, to maybe spread some of this knowledge that's being laid on us today in a wider audience of our families and our homes, at the college here, in the world, that's really exciting to me. That's what we're really here for at college, in my opinion. And so that's what I'm grateful for. So a couple etiquette things. How many of you have never been to an academic conference before? Most of us, yay, I love that. I did not attend an academic conference until graduate school. That is more the typical experience, right? I don't know if it's the same for you, Marie? And it's not something that's encouraged or pushed. And so just having your butt in a seat right now is pretty cool. You can put this on your resume. It usually goes in a section called professional development or conferences or further education. And so for real, when you leave here, go update your resume with the fact that you sat here, had some snacks, and listened to some awesome people share awesome stuff with you. Some etiquette things would be taking notes, as I mentioned earlier, being ready to talk during the Q&A, but also, unless you're taking notes on your cell phone, have your cell phone away, please. It is the modern age, so probably lots of you would take notes on your cell phone. I understand that. But make sure they're on silent. And eye contact, really important. We get a lot from that, right? Like, we get a lot of, like, oh, they're listening, they're paying attention. Nod at appropriate moments. If there's a joke, laugh. If there's not a joke, don't laugh. If you can't tell the difference, maybe don't laugh. I don't know, err on the side of not. And then the last thing I wanted to say to you all before I give this over to our wonderful presenters is you can be involved in this next year. And we have two presenters at the conference this year who were just random audience members last year and who talked to me after, how do I get involved? How do I do this? And I said the thing I said to you, like, pester your instructors to submit your work. If your work is submitted and you're published, you have the opportunity to also get up here and present. I have had people who've participated in this conference come back and tell me, I got that scholarship I applied for, I got that job I applied for, and they told me that my attendance, my participation in this conference was part of why, because that really set me apart. So think about ways you could get involved next year. I would love to see some of you in the audience up here. And with that, I think we will give it over. And the talk today, as most of you probably already know, death and dying. If any of you get emotionally triggered at any point during this conference, that's normal and it's okay, and I'll cry with you. And we have a box of tissues right here if you need them. Just come up and grab one. Does anyone know they're gonna need a tissue already? Like, I could just bring you one right now by show of hands. Yeah, this girl needs one. Me and her, we're together. We're already crying, you know. All right, sweet. And I, with that, it's take
it away. Thank you. Thank you. Did you get this out? Oh, I think I'll be okay. I'll use my sleeves. I'll be a 3-year-old.
I'll run up to
it. My name is Britton Lutzi. I want to thank everybody for being here today. I am going to be sharing a personal essay that I wrote. It's entitled Fear, Forgiveness, and Gratitude. And then I will be showing a short picture collage set to song, and it will all kind of make sense after I'm done reading my essay. My mother, Nancy Joyce Tracy, passed away suddenly on June 13th, 2015. I was her third and last child, her baby girl. Our family secrets were long and wide, and in the chasm in between, my mom and I had a very tumultuous relationship. Since I can remember, my mom was physically and mentally abusive towards me, as well as being incredibly emotionally unavailable. My mom most likely had borderline personality disorder. I grew up trying to please her, all the while walking on eggshells to ensure that I wouldn't do something to make her erupt. Eruptions happened often, but she could usually hold it in until we were alone, and then she would unleash her fury on me. This story is about how in the midst of her dying, I was able to forgive her, and in the year and a half since her passing, how I found myself. I no longer walk in fear, but in light and truth, and am thankful for every moment of my past that has brought me forward and present. My mom had been living in a state-run nursing home for the 6 months prior to her death. It was a place that people went to die, not live. Although my siblings and I didn't know that at the time. The night before my mom passed away, my brother called to tell me that my mom had been slurring her speech all day. My stepfather had assumed that she had a stroke. When I called to talk to the nurse on staff, she told me that my mom had a plethora of symptoms, but had signed a DNR, which is a do not resuscitate. And by under no circumstances should she be transported to a hospital. I asked the nurse if my mom was dying, and she said no. Not yes or maybe, but an affirmative no. As soon as I hung up the phone, I looked at my husband and said, "She's dying. We need to go down first thing in the morning so I can be with her. Please help me find scripture to read over her." At this point in my life, I was not very spiritual, but I knew God was moving me to tell her things that he knew she needed to hear before passing. While my husband and I scoured the Bible and highlighted passages to read, I wrote my mom a letter. Here's an excerpt from that letter. "I want you to know that I forgive you for everything. I know you did the best you could with what you had been given, which I realize wasn't much. Yes, I've been mad at you. You were far from perfect, but so was I. I just wanted you to be there for me and wake up with a smile. I understand now how life makes you tired. My hope for you, Mom, is that you get to go to heaven soon and feel his divine love, the love that you have been searching for on earth." When I arrived at her nursing home the next morning, the ambulance was already there. She was in so much pain, the nurse said she had asked to go to the hospital. My mom was slurring her speech, her jaw was shaking uncontrollably, and she was having what looked like seizures. It wasn't long after we arrived at the emergency room that the doctor informed me that her heart rate was slowing. The signs pointed to what I already knew in my gut. I asked how long she had, and he said he wasn't sure. I walked back into the room and asked all the nurses to please leave me alone with her. That is when I was able to read the letter to her, read scripture over her, and tell her to go to the light where there would be no more pain or tears. As I sobbed and kissed her forehead, I watched my mom take her last breath, and the monitor registered a flat red line on the screen. She was gone. It was an incredible honor to be with the woman who brought me into this world as she exited this world. It truly was a first full circle moment and a gift that I will cherish forever. 30 days before my mother's death, I had been brought to my knees by an addiction that had plagued me for nearly 3 decades. During that time, I stood and drank from the well of my addiction, completely disconnected from myself and others. It was an awful place to be, devoid of any light, lonely, cold, and scary. Everything in me wanted to live in a place of safety, peace, comfort, to be present in every moment, and to have God stand in the gaps for me when I couldn't. And God did. God showed up in bold ways for me. I started to believe that I could have all those things that I had forever craved for and desired. God started waking me up with scripture or words to meditate on. Prayers were being answered right before my eyes. God, fully man and woman, carried me with fatherly strength and maternal wisdom. When my siblings and I were preparing for my mom's funeral, it was asked by the pastor if any of us were going to speak and deliver her eulogy. My brother and sister had opted out, and so did her adult grandchildren. In my need to be heard and seen, I volunteered to give her eulogy. It was not your normal eulogy, listing her achievements, accolades, or milestones. Instead, God woke me up early one morning and gave me this. When I was thinking about what I was going to say today in remembrance of my mom, I thought I would talk about special memories we shared and moments had. After a lot of prayer, it suddenly came to me at 5:30 in the morning. What came to me early that morning was that I would like to honor my mom by talking about these 3 things: fear, forgiveness, and gratitude. Growing up, I had looked at my mother as living in a state of fear. Now that I've become an adult and a mother, I realize how much strength she had. I attribute my own strength to her. Where some of my greatest fears lie are also where some of my greatest strengths stand. I know that my mom would want me to say to all of us, go, live bravely. Don't live in a spirit of fear. Live each day as if it's your last, and love like crazy. On the day my mom passed, God blessed me with the opportunity to be with her during her final hours. During that precious time, I was able to do a myriad of things with her, but the most important of all was the forgiveness that took place. As a theologian, Reinhold Niebuhr said, forgiveness is the final form of love. Life is too short to hold on to resentment. Please, today if you need, forgive someone you love. It is the most courageous thing you can do. I am so grateful that she is now home for eternity with Christ. She will never suffer, cry, or be in pain again. She is free and whole. Her soul is now forever in peace. Thank you, Mom, for teaching me these things. For in spite of challenges, be it anger or fear, be grateful for each moment you have, because time is precious. To end, here is a quote from one of my favorite authors, Anne Vascamp. The world is really beautiful when you slow down to look at it. My mother's death ended one journey in my life, only to begin another. Since her passing, I've grown in wisdom and stature. Every day I become more and more of the woman God intended me to be. I live in my truth now. My new journey has been difficult, holy, heart-shattering, heart-mending, beautiful, and amazing. My eyes are open, my ears are listening, and my heart is learning, and I wouldn't want it any other way.
Well, I heard there was a secret chord, a David played. you don't really care for music, do ya? Well, it goes like this, the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, and the major lift, the baffled king composing hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Well, your faith was strong, but you needed proof. You saw it bathing on the roof. How beautiful. She tied you to a kitchen chair. She broke your throat and she cut your hair. And from her lips she drew the hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. I am Elize Wilsey, but most people just call me E because Elize is kind of difficult for a lot of people. It's even difficult for me sometimes. And I wrote a paper about learning from the dead, which happened to be about my best friend growing up. And his name was Andrew Mansard, and he was one of the most fantastic people I've ever known. And I do hope you read my paper, because I'm not going to read directly from it today, because I figure everyone gets something different out of it. But today I'm going to talk about what I got from Andrew and everything that he has taught me and how I learned to live my life, and hopefully some lessons that you all take away with it. I had known him since the third grade, and the day that we became friends was also an awful day for me, an awful day for a third grade girl, because two girls pinned me down in the bathroom and shaved my eyebrows off. Anyone who tells you little kids cannot be mean is lying. He told me that I looked cool, that I looked like, you know, some sort of badass alien. And that was the day we became friends. And at the time, I was like, who is this kid? But he taught me a lot growing up. He was always there for other people. He took care of his mom because his dad wasn't around. And he was always there for me because I had a lot of expectations put on me from a very young age. And it was nice to have his emotional support since I couldn't really get anyone else's. We found out that he was diagnosed with leukemia in 2013, which was very difficult because having someone who's there for you all the time and switching roles and figuring out how to be there for them during probably one of the worst times in their life, because chemo was never fun. I can't tell you how many times I sat up with him in the bathroom in the middle of the night and he'd just puke his guts out and cry and puke some more and talk, and he'd try to act like he was always okay. He was probably the strongest person I've ever known, because if I was in that situation, I don't know how I would be able to laugh and joke and just still be spontaneous and fun and go jump into pools fully clothed and break into movie theaters, just because, you know, you want to see more than one movie when you go to the movie theater. And he was just amazing, so I never realized anything was actually wrong until on June 17th, 2014, I had found out that he'd killed himself, which was very difficult for me to cope with. In the five stages of grief, I definitely stayed in the anger section a lot more than I should have. And this was my first ever time really dealing with grief, and I didn't know how to handle it, because growing up, my parents told me emotions are sort of a side note. You need to figure out how to, you know, keep pushing forward. You need to figure out how to make it to class every day, make it to your clubs every day, stuff like that. There's time to grieve later. And so I just pushed my grief to the side. I acted like I was okay. I took care of his mother, and that was that. And a year later, everything just kind of came busted out. I was angry at the world. I was just angry at everyone. I felt like no one was worth my time, and I just kind of shut myself into a bubble, which is not the way you should live. And then around the time when we had to write this paper and everything, I was listening to a song that Alex used to play on his guitar all the time. Alex is his older brother who taught him how to play guitar. And I was just listening to the song, and I just started swaying along. And it reminded me of one of my last nights with Andrew, which he was puking from chemo, he was crying, he was so upset, and we just kind of sat on the floor together. And he was like, you know what, Jellyfish, which was my nickname because I danced like a jellyfish. He was like, you know what, Jellyfish, you're gonna do just fine. But I don't wanna see you sad. I don't want to see you, you know, upset because of me. I want you to continue doing everything you love, and I want you to continue just being you. And one of the things I love to do is dance, even if I dance stupidly like a jellyfish. And I just started learning to do the stuff I love again, which is what I talk about in my paper, is I just learned to be spontaneous and just do the things I love again and the things I used to do with him. And it's amazing how that helped me eventually cope with the fact that he was gone. And then the night that I was writing this paper, I felt that anger coming back up again, like, how can someone so fantastic and so wonderful just up and die and leave me and everything like that? And then I realized that near the end of his life, he didn't feel that fantastic. He didn't feel that wonderful. He didn't really feel like he was anything anymore. He was just kind of numb. And that was probably the saddest realization to me, because I knew no matter what, he was fantastic and wonderful. I just forgot to tell him. I forgot to remind him that, dude, you're my best friend, and you are one of the most fantastic human beings on this earth, and if you were to leave, that would be it. There'd be one less fantastic human being. And at the same time, I realized, like, a lot of people don't get reminded that. A lot of our loved ones, everyone that we love dearly, we just assume that they know. They know that they're fantastic, they're wonderful, they're just a big part of our lives, but we forget to tell them. And I realized that's just an issue with right now, is we don't pay attention to how others are feeling, we don't pay attention to each other very much anymore. We don't realize that sometimes we need to be told that you're someone's best friend, that they need you in their life. Because a lot of times we hit low points where we feel like no one needs us around. I've felt like that. I'm sure everyone in this room has felt like that. And just, Andrew's death helped me pay attention more. It's helped me make friends again. It's helped me just grow as a person and pay attention to my friends' feelings. And just, I remind them all the time, even if it's annoying, that they are fantastic and wonderful, and I want to keep them around forever. They are not allowed to go before I go. And I just hope that you remember that at the end of someone's life, the living tend to have more regrets than the dead do. So live your life making sure everyone knows how loved they are. That's it.
Can we get another round of applause for our wonderful presenters collectively? So I try not to be the first one to ask a question, but I'm doing that this time. I'm claiming the right because I have the microphone in my hand and no one can stop me. You could, but you're not going to. So I want to start by making a comment about both of your presentations, and then maybe lead into a question if I can think of what the question is as I'm blabbering. First of all, just thanks again for getting up here and being so vulnerable in front of us and sharing that with us. It's really important work. I want to address the theme that emerged in both of your pieces of perspective shift. I think it's clear to all of us that that really showed up in what they just shared with us, this idea of shifting perspective. And there are lots of ways we get perspective shifts in our lives, right? And one is, you become a mom. So you understand what your mom dealt with maybe, right? And you maybe get a little more forgiving stance. And death is sort of the biggest sort of perspective check of all. Like, oh, hello, examine your life. Where's it going? What are you doing? And I think anytime we have an encounter with death or a new perspective, it has a way of asking us to examine and turn toward our own lives. That's really, really beautiful. And you said something just now, his death helped me pay attention, right, to what people might need around me. I know that after my own mother died, one thing, I had a similar mother experience to you where my mother was not emotionally available. I don't really have a memory of her ever telling me she loved me or hugging me or anything. And that was a process for me, just like with you, like coming around, having that full circle experience. And now every day, one of the first things I do with both of my children is I look them in the eye and I say, have I told you today that I love you? Have I told you that you are the most special little boy or little girl on the planet to me? And they go, yeah, you already told me that, Mom. I'm like, okay, I'm telling you again right now, you hear me? And those things are important, telling people the things we feel about them, as you just stressed to us, E. And so I don't really know what my question is so much as just I wanted to invite you all to be able to talk about the perspective shifts and that part of your experience of writing this or looking at this. And I'd even like to invite your instructor, Marie Feldmeier. She's incredible, by the way, to take classes with this woman. I'd like to invite your instructor to maybe speak to that topic too of the perspective shift and what all maybe you've learned in teaching this class, Death and Dying, when it comes to that. Maybe even invite you just to start out, sure, if that's okay with you.
Yeah, this is a very important topic, and I think that sometimes it startles us when we realize we can see things from a different perspective. I mean, that's sort of the first step, I think. It's just realizing, wow, I don't have to kind of be trapped in certain ruts of thought or habits of experiencing the world in certain ways. There are other possibilities. There are other ways of being in the world, other kinds of fundamental attitudes we can have toward life and toward toward the rest of our lives. And so realizing that there is that freedom to direct your attention in whatever way you want, to approach life in whatever way you want, to interpret your experience in a way that supports your well-being and the well-being of others rather than undercuts it. That's exciting, to realize that we all have that freedom as human beings. And then to actually shift perspective can be life-changing and transformative. And one thing that is such a joy about teaching this course is that we often look to people who are nearing their death for wisdom, because this is a pattern that we see again and again, that people who get closer to death often naturally shift perspectives in ways that are illuminating and life-giving and really, you know, can provide rich and exciting insights. And so we read in the class Tuesdays with Maury and Man's Search for Meaning and talk about what these wisdom figures have to tell us, and learn from people who experience death in some way, maybe through having a terminal illness themselves, or maybe through walking with someone who's going through a terminal illness. And then we gain insight ourselves from that person's perspective shift and maybe learn to see things in a new way. In the book Tuesdays with Maury, Maury Schwartz, who's a man dying of ALS, says, you know, with this disease, I've learned that the most important thing is to learn how to give out love and let it in. And he spent his whole life in academia. He was a sociology professor. And so he was, you know, lived like many of us do, kind of in the land of the intellect. And so at the end of his life, he has these revelations. And by reading the book, we can gain that insight while we still have so much life ahead of us. And so one thing that we can do in thinking about the finitude of our lives, our human mortality, is think, what kind of perspective do I want to have? What kind of perspective can I embrace that will enrich my life and promote my own well-being and that of others, and lead me to be the kind of person that I really am capable of being in the world? And we have that freedom now, which is so exciting. And so I would invite us to, you know, think about the various ways of approaching life, the kinds of perspectives that we can have, and intentionally choose how we want to be in the world and what kind of life we really want to have, so that by the time we get to the end of it, we're not filled with regret or anger or frustration, but rather gratitude and a sense of serenity. So I hope that speaks to your comment. Yeah.
Do you have anything you'd like to add?
The thing that I can compare most to my perspective shift is, it's like you walk into your house and all your furniture's still there, but everything was shifted slightly to the right a bit. And at first you don't really notice until you start bashing your knee into everything and you realize like things have been completely changed, and you have to learn how to live like that. Like, let's just pretend your furniture's glued to the floor now. like some dude came into your house, took your furniture, shifted it an inch to the right and glued it to the floor. You learn to live like that, but at the same time you know something's changed. You will always know that something has changed, and you figure out how to live with it and not bash your knee anymore.
I've spent years in therapy, and I'm just gonna throw that out there, and I think everybody should. But I remember telling a therapist years ago that I didn't think I was gonna be able to forgive my mom until she was gone, or until that moment before she was going. And my therapist said, no, you have to deal with all this stuff before she goes, because you're gonna have regrets. But that's when I was able to shift, and that's when I was able to have that perspective of forgiveness. And it's not that I don't have to daily sometimes forgive her, or monthly or yearly. There are things come up still that I have to continually forgive her for. But yeah, it did. It gave me a greater sense of gratitude and that peace and serenity. And being with her when she went was like, gosh, you can't take anything with you. So what really matters in this life is relationship and love.
And may we all have friends as good as Alex, who, if our eyebrows get shaved off, they could give us the different perspective that we just look like a badass. I hope you all have a friend in the room who would do that for you if that moment happened to you. Who is next? The question or a comment. I will bring the mic to you if you show me a hand.
I'm already crying, but my best friend died about a year ago, and I just really love to hear what you had to say, because it feels like a freight train has hit you. It was a car crash. It was very sudden. She was here one day, she was gone the next. And we didn't live in the same cities anymore. And I hadn't seen her in a little while, you know, because you have all the time in the world, and then it's gone. And so I just really love to hear what you had to say, because I just really went through that perspective change where I wake up every day and I make sure that the people that are important to me know it, and that I carve out the time in my life to make sure that those relationships are strong. You know, but also to come to the conclusion that I can't feel guilty and I can't feel regret that I hadn't seen her in a couple of months, because you just can't live that way. And I just have to remember her for the wonderful person that she was and the wonderful relationship that we had. So I just really, I could never have articulated it that well. So it was really cool to hear it. So thank you.
Thank you. All right, who is next with a question or a comment?
One of the things I've thought about a lot, and then listening to both of you, and my father died years back unexpectedly, and it seems like, and I'm interested to hear what you'd have to say, that in connection with the benefits almost of going through these type of experiences, we realize that it's kind of really directly attached to our false senses of control. That especially in our day and age and technology and everything else, we become so comfortable, so reliant on so many things, and so many things are a constant and are in our grasp. And then things like this come up, and it really sets everything, like you're saying, in perspective, and allows us to really step back. And in a way, it seems like that growth and that ability to really, in some ways, find kind of a truer happiness comes when we can find ourselves resting in the place where we acknowledge and accept that there are a lot of things in life that we can't control.
Do you guys want to speak to that? There was a quote in some of you were here for the second panel of the day, and I think one of our speakers from that second, maybe she was in the first panel, and it was the first panel of the day, she said, to deny death is to deny life, which I think is in keeping with what you just said, right, a little bit. Do you guys have anything you want to add, or because I don't know if there was a question there. Yeah.
Definitely when losing someone, you do have to give up a lot of control, and you realize that you don't have control, because if we had control, we'd keep them around forever. We'd have all the time in the world to spend with them. Once you realize you have no control, it does put a lot of it into perspective about how much time you really have with people and how we should make time for people in our lives, and definitely forgiving people and how much bravery that takes. Because tomorrow's like the most terrifying thing out there. You don't know what's gonna happen tomorrow. You don't know if you're gonna end up in a car crash, if you're gonna get fired, you don't know. And so it takes a lot of bravery to face tomorrow and just give up control sometimes.
I think for me, it's been freeing to be able to give up that control. And to just, it's not in my hands. So yeah, to live the best life that I can and treat people the best way that I can and love people the best way that I can.
I'd like to add something, if that's okay. In the class, we read a book called Man's Search for Meaning by Viktor Frankl, and Frankl is a Holocaust survivor. He spent 3 years in 4 concentration camps, and one of the central themes in this incredibly wise and insightful book is that we're often in circumstances in which we can't control the conditions that we happen to be in. You know, one might find oneself as a prisoner of war or just in very difficult conditions. A loved one might die. There are all kinds of things, yeah, that we can't control, and it's very difficult to give up that sense of control and kind of embrace the vulnerability that we have as humans, but Frankl also emphasizes that that one thing that's never taken away from us, and that's our freedom to choose how we respond to the conditions that we may be in, or how we respond to what's happened to us. And one reason that I asked Britt and E to speak today is that I was so inspired and moved by their response to what happened. It's deeply inspired. And so, you know, so here is Britt, and she's had this very difficult relationship for years and years, and various kinds of challenges and struggle and adversity, and she responds in this, you know, incredibly beautiful way with forgiveness and gratitude and love, and even putting together the montage of photographs was a beautiful act of love toward this woman who really created a lot of suffering in her life. And I thought, what a model for how to respond in a skillful, inspiring way. And same with E. I was so delighted by the stories of her and Andrew, and she didn't go into detail about this, but at one point, you know, Andrew said, you know, let's jump in the pool, and they both had all their clothes on, and they jumped in this pool, you know, with all their clothes on. Wasn't it in the middle of the night or something like that?
Yeah, we were lifeguards at the Reed Ridge Rec Center.
Yeah, and so, you know, so there was this in Andrew, this wonderful kind of playfulness and spontaneity, and in dealing with his death and the loss of him, she embraced him and continued to love him by kind of embodying the insights that he imparted and the person that he was in how she was going to go forward in her own life. So she talked in my class about how she, you know, as she was sort of working through this grief and anger, she went dancing, you know, she went dancing. And I thought, what a beautiful response to death and loss, to tragedy, is to think, you know, how can I take this beauty, this beautiful soul, you know, that that has walked with me for so long, and honor him, and kind of internalize the kind of creativity and spontaneity and life that his whole life embodied, and so that those responses struck me as deeply instructive, and so that's why I asked them to present. I thought, here they were facing conditions that nobody would want to face, you know, extremely difficult challenges and adversity, and yet their response has been growth-oriented and creative and life-giving and full of love, and that was so moving to me. So that's why I wanted that's why I wanted them to talk to you. Yeah.
Okay, who would like me to bring the mic over to them to make a comment or a question?
I think we've got one here.
You were hiding behind
whatever this thing's called.
I'm actually really glad that you both had written what you did, because I come from both of those situations, actually, where my mom is she's not physically abusive, but she's certainly emotionally and verbally abusive. And then my friend Cody died in December. And it was like a couple of weeks ago, I was sitting there, or not a couple of weeks ago, last week I was sitting there and I was like, I'm gonna get kicked out of the house and I can't, like, I go to college, I work, I babysit, like I can't afford a house because I'm in college. And I was like, I'm gonna have to drop out of school and give up on doing psychology for my career. And then I was like, Cody would smack me right now. Cody would have yelled at me and been like, that's stupid, like, just stay, just, you can do it, you power through it, you know. He's like that guardian angel, but, you know, he's a human and doesn't have wings. I mean, now he has wings, but, you know. So I'm really glad to hear, because I was like, oh, no one's gonna relate to me, right? I'm a special snowflake. So I'm really glad that you guys had experiences that we can all relate to.
Okay, I'm ready to travel to you if you have a comment or a question. Okay, with that, I think we'll just give you one more round of applause and thank you for being here today and sharing that with us.